Savior.
Excited to be here this morning. I think I seen some of you in the about a year ago? Yeah, so it's exciting. I'm excited to be here today. That song about every praise to God, I say amen. I'm ready to praise God. I don't know about you, but I am ready to praise God. One of the things I was thinking about is by the way, my name is Ray Rowan, for those that don't know. And I'm gonna be doing the welcome. But one of the things I thought about was just this passage in Luke 4, verse 18, and it's also found in Isaiah 61, verse 1. And it says, I'm starting in verse 16, it says, he went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, the Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Wow, that passage resonates with me a lot. I think for some of us here today, some of you might feel captive. You know, feel like you're in prison. You know, due to the COVID, some of you may feel that way. You're being locked down. By the way, I just had my shot yesterday of the vaccine, so I'm happy about that. One and done, and I'm official. So I'm excited about that. But some of you may feel that way. I know this week, my wife, Princess, we was having an elders meeting, a Zoom call. And my wife came into the room, and I was on the call, and we were going through some things there. And she just started talking to me and explaining about her date. And she said something to me about her brother-in-law, and her cousin was going to be taken off a ventilator. And so I was stung when I heard that. But, you know, I'm a creature of habit, so I said, okay, we'll talk about that. So I went back to the call. Then I thought and said, whoa. I need to listen here. So I got off the call and went back and tried to comfort my wife, Princess. I don't know if I did. I didn't say anything. I just listened. So hopefully it worked. But I think at that time, she needed some comfort. She needed some relief. She felt a little bit oppressed. I think, too, the other thing was that, they did put him back on the ventilator. He's still not out of the woods. He's still fighting for his life, so you could be praying for him. His name is James Hillman. I think some of you might be feeling captive because of just what's been happening on the news, all the violence that we've been hearing. Just in Atlanta alone, we had, 10 people killed in the shooting? Then we had in Boulder, Colorado, if I'm not mistaken, some more people was killed. So some of you may feel captive. You need to be released. You need some freedom. And I think that's what Jesus is all about. I think one of the things, too, here is that even with that, it was amazing that the Israelites in this particular subject with this area was looking at Jesus, looking for a Messiah, someone that was going to give them this freedom, but they wanted the freedom as to annihilate the Romans. That's the freedom they wanted from. But that's not Jesus. That was not Jesus' message. His message is that he's going to die for his enemies. And he's going to give peace to those in need. I'm going to read the scripture one more time. The Spirit of the Lord is on me. Because he has appointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, he has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the years of the Lord's favor. Would you pray with me? God, we are just so grateful for this opportunity. We're grateful, Lord, that we could be together today. Those who are able to come out, those online, we're just grateful that you've shown us so much mercy, so much love, and you care for us deeply. Lord, we know there's so much evil out there, so much hatred, but yet you protect us, you love us, and you care for us. I pray, God, that your spirit will be with, you'll be with us as we open up our hearts to you. I pray for those that are hurting from the COVID, those that lost loved ones, those that are hurting from the violence that happened downtown in Atlanta, those that are hurting from the violence that happened in Boulder, Colorado, and those that are struggling from the storms that happened. We pray that, God, you'll really help them, bless them, and I pray that, Lord, today that our eyes and ears will be open to your words, and your spirit will be among us. Thank you for giving us freedom through you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
So we're going to go ahead and sing a couple more songs, really focus in on who God is and really our need for our Lord and Savior.
The living word singing loud. life is almost gone. You see my heart and you lead me home. You give me courage to carry on. I need you more. I need you more. I need you more than my very
to our Father in the midst of the wind and the rain.
I see you in the wind and rain. I feel your whisper and I hear your name. I see
Please be seated.
Hey, let's pray before we start. Father, we bow before you. God, we need you so desperately. We need you more and more every day. God, we can't get enough. We know we just scratched the surface of your love for us. How much you've given us, God, that you have just lavished us with grace and your blessings. God, we are extremely, extremely humbled and blown away that we get to walk with you. I pray, God, that you would help us grow more in love with your presence, that we would grow more in love with walking with you. We'd be filled with your spirit and be your light in this world. God, I pray that you would be with what we talk about today, that it would be encouraging and that would bring us closer together. We love you. Amen. Well, good morning, everybody. My name is Nick, and this is my incredible wife, Bree. And so we are excited to be together this morning with everybody. We really loved what Jeff and Chase did a few weeks ago, where they were up here, you know, getting a chance to talk together. And so we're like, hey, we're married. We should be able to, you know, copy them on that one. And we don't have to be that distance because we live together, which is pretty awesome. Right. So, and we have these cool mics. We might do a duet together at some point. And so we feel, you know, kind of cool in that way. So our overview for the year, right, has been faithful together. And it's been really cool. We've been going through, you know, starting off the year in January, talking about how God is faithful. In February, we had our incredible fast. We moved into some of the names of God and how he provides for us on a consistent basis. We talked about just how much, like, his faithfulness. Now we're moving in more to the family of God. We talked about being one in Christ. Last week, Tom talked about rich and poor being one in God's kingdom. And now we're going to talk a little bit today about old and young. And all generations, okay? And so we're really excited about that. Bree and I feel like we have a really cool opportunity on a daily basis where we get a chance to kind of bridge that gap between old and young every day, working with young people, trying to help them understand and have humility with older people and vice versa. So we have a really cool opportunity, you know, every day to be able to get a chance to do that. And we're excited to share some of the things that we've learned along the way. Real quickly, we have a couple of people that are really excited about being faithful together this year. Over the past few days, we had Jordan Whitcomb and John Wells get engaged, which was awesome. They serve kind of with our youth and family ministry, and they are incredible servants. They were engaged a few days ago. And then as well as Sam and Maggie were engaged. And so we've had a lot of people that are really they're excited about being faithful together this year, and it's going to be awesome. So the Bible talks often about all generations. From the first few pages of the Bible to the end, it talks about God's promises being for everyone. It talks about God's promises being for all generations. You see it in, I love this passage here in Psalm 78 where it says, "We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. He commanded our ancestors to teach their children so the next generation would know them. Even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands." You know, God, from the beginning of scripture, he used people like Caleb, 85 years old, saying, "I want the hill country. Give me the hill country." Or you got people like Mary that are teenagers that God is using them to bring the Messiah into the world and trusted teenagers to be part of that plan. All throughout scriptures, God has used them in extraordinary ways. And also today as well.
Mm-hmm. And I love how it doesn't really matter how old you are. In God's kingdom, everyone is welcome to be a part of the dream. You know, a couple weeks ago, Ashley got baptized and she's 16 years old. A few months before that, Ms. Doris got baptized. She's 98. And I just love that it doesn't matter how old you are. You are a part of the dream of God's kingdom.
Totally. But, you know, even though we love being part of the family together, there are some differences between old and young. You know, maybe you've realized that over the years. You know, our title for the day is Talking About My Generation, okay? If you get that reference, then you know the song. If you don't, then that just shows and proves my point that we have a lot of differences, you know, in our generations. One is just talk about our slang, okay? Think about when you were growing up, what was kind of the slang that was used, you know, as you were going around your school. For those of you guys that remember, Travis Hawkins came and spoke to our teens for the Southeast Teen Rally a few years ago. And he was up here and was speaking to the church and said, "I see you with the drip. And you know that what that means for us young people that know that, it means I like your clothes. Right. You know, I was talking to Kevin and Noel, my in-laws, after that, and Kevin's like, what is drip? Is that like, I don't know why he's like Italian or something like that, you know, but like, it's like, is that like a coffee or a disease? Like, what is that? And it's like, you know, so there's definitely, each generation has a different outlook on the world, has different values. Like, we value different things depending on what generation you grew up in. And we come from totally different environments. I think because we are different, that provides a lot of opportunities for fear and for the differences to speak louder than our similarities and the things that we are united on. We start to distance ourselves from each other often. We start to lose trust between each other, where we start kind of not trusting each other very much. And Jesus is really calling us to live faithfully in our relationships, not just to live faithfully yourself out in the world, but when it comes to each other, I think he wants us to be courageous and faithful with one another. Faithfulness is about leaning in. It's about trusting one another. It's about loving one another. The younger generation choosing to reach up and the older generation choosing to reach down and doing this together. Mm-hmm. Because we cannot love if we do not trust. Mm-hmm. 1 Corinthians 13 tells us that love always trusts. Mm-hmm. Not sometimes, not when you're comfortable in it. Love always trusts.
And I think I'm so excited to talk about this today because we want to talk about what does love always trust look like between older and younger people right now. You know, I think especially this last year, it has been tumultuous in so many ways. I think there's been topics that have challenged our thinking, right? Caused us to rethink beliefs. And I think it's caused a bigger divide than what feels like than ever between older and younger. You know, and just a few days ago, I was talking to a friend of mine who's, you know, young married in the church, a couple I respect a lot, and her husband's a black man, and she was just sharing some of the experiences he's had this last year, specifically talking to some older people where he's felt like, wow, we really feel differently about some things. You know, wow, I'm seeing where you're coming from, and that's not where I'm coming from, and it's easy to get disillusioned. And I think when sometimes, especially years like this, times like this, it's easy to just think, like, who can we trust? You know, who can I trust? And I've been recently humbled in this area, even just in the last few weeks. I was in some conversations with some disciples who are in their 60s, and I was really humbled because I had assumed that they would come from a certain perspective just because of the generation that they're in, and they didn't, and I felt like, wow, I realized how much I didn't trust, honestly, mm-hmm. and I really didn't trust, and I think my assumptions made me view them as a them. And I think when we make it an us and them thing, it's really hard to love the way that Jesus loved.
Yeah, it's so true. So how do we come together? How do we build that trust between us? You know, there are three things I think Jesus did so phenomenally well in all of his interactions with people. You know, Jesus tells us to become like little children. He says that he doesn't even say become like the wise old people. He says become like little children. That's a really interesting teaching, you know, from Jesus on that. And so the three things that even we wanted to talk about, we're going to bring it back. If we're going to try to be like Jesus, we're going to bring it back to going back to VBS, okay? We're going to VBS. And Melissa's going to like, you know, we're even plugging VBS. Hopefully that's coming in the summer. It's going to be awesome. But VBS, and what we're going to talk about today is the idea of valuing, believing, and serving one another. When you do those three things in your relationships, it changes everything. Jesus, in every one of his interactions, he valued, he believed in, and then he served. All the interactions that he has all throughout the Gospels. One of the things I love, what is the only thing that we know about Jesus when he was a young 12-year-old, is that he was listening and asking questions of people that were older than him. Mm-hmm. But then when he's older, what is he doing? He's saying, hey, let the little children come to me. Actually, the kingdom belongs to little children. Mm-hmm. Jesus knew the importance of all generations. Mm-hmm. When we act faithfully in those ways, when we trust one another, when we value, believe, and serve, that cycle perpetuates. Mm-hmm. When you feel that way, when you feel like someone does that for you, you want to go and do that for other people. So we want to talk to both generations on that for a minute. We want to talk first to the older generation because, you know, younger generation, we get offended more easily. So we'll talk to you guys first and we'll get to the younger generation second, okay? But we're kind of talking about anybody that's kind of 40 and older. If you're 39 today, you're welcome. You're part of the younger generation, okay? So get fired up about that. But the younger generation is growing up in a completely different world. Mm-hmm. It is like an alien planet, you know, versus 50 years ago, okay? It's a completely different world. And sometimes I think the younger generation gets a little bit of a bad rap because it seems like just a bunch of kids scrolling on their phones, kind of entitled, and that's all they do. And it doesn't take, but I believe it doesn't really take long for you to walk, as you walk a mile in their shoes, for you to get some compassion and some empathy about what they're facing today on a day-to-day basis.
You know, if you think about it, this generation, like Gen Z, millennials, we are getting bombarded with hundreds of messages every day, information overload. And it's at our fingertips at all times. And I think specifically with social media, there's a constant comparison that's happening. It's a constant looking and saying, I am not enough. That I should be more, you know, and I felt like this point was really emphasized. I was talking to a teen girl recently, and she was just sharing, you know, typically on a Friday night, she was just sharing kind of, you know, I'll sit in my bed, and I'll just sit and scroll on social media, and, you know, Snapchat, Instagram, and I will just look at all my friends hanging out, all the people having fun, all the people, you know, that are looking beautiful, and she will just scroll, and then she'll turn her phone off, she'll lay down, she'll look at the ceiling fan. And these are the thoughts going through her head. Nobody remembers me. Nobody cares about me. I am forgotten. And I think these are the kind of messages that are going through the minds of our young people all the time.
It's amazing now. We are the most connected generation of all time, but there's also studies that say we are the loneliest generation of all time. And so we need incredible support. I think we also get a little bit criticized. The younger generation gets a little bit criticized for not respecting authority or kind of accepting truth really easily. When you think about what they've grown up hearing, they've grown up watched big businesses or politicians or celebrities or athletes or even famous religious figures that have been caught in scandals that have abused their influence and their power. And so it doesn't take long to say, man, it is easy to be a little bit skeptical, you know, out there. And so a lot of times I think it's easy to say, why don't you have conviction about things? Why don't you kind of like, you know, in my day we believed in the truth, and it feels like everybody's kind of believing their own truth. And I think there's a time and place for that. But I think really what the younger generation feels is they are craving, they're crying out to be heard, to be seen, to be valued, to be validated. And when we feel that way, when we feel safe, then the truth comes naturally with that. And they're getting that flood of that those kind of things on a daily basis, instantaneously. Mm-hmm. Our generation, the younger generation, needs the good news of Jesus so bad. So bad. But not talking about it more, honestly. We need to see the gospel and the good news of Jesus lived out courageously in the people that we are looking up to. Mm-hmm. Because I think there's also been studies that there are a lot of people that leave church as they grow older, because Christianity was always theory, and it was always theology, and they never actually saw, how does this play out in my practical everyday life? We need, as we are mentors, and as we are going before people that are younger than us, we gotta show them how it makes a difference in our personal lives, and how it makes a difference also in the world. Mm-hmm. We desperately need to see the older generation still going for it, mm-hmm. and still say, man, I'm still making courageous decisions for Jesus. It's not a bunch of just old stories we're talking about, you know, from college, but we're going for it today. And we're making a difference today, and we still love Jesus, and waking up every day trying to figure out how to please him even today. Mm-hmm. We need that so desperately. And the most amazing thing I love about our family here is that there are so many examples of people that are doing that. And I am so inspired and grateful that we have a family of people that care about the younger generation and are still going for it even more than they were when they were younger. And so what do we need? We need that as a younger generation. I also feel like to feel valued, believed in, and served, one of the most important things we need is listening, mm-hmm. in a safe place where we can express and feel valued.
Mm-hmm. You know, one of my mentors is Lynn Ottenweiler. I'm so grateful for her. And she said this the other day and it stood out to me. She said, when we don't have a safe person to unravel with, we just get wound tighter and tighter, and we get harder, and we trust less as time goes on. You know, and I think that's so true. And a friend was telling me the other day that, you know, she can be afraid sometimes to talk to people that are in an older generation because she just kind of expects that they're not going to listen. You know, I think sometimes as younger people, we can fear that older people are going to respond to us just with quick correction or quick judgment. you know, kind of immediate kind of an answer rather than listening. Or sometimes I think we can fear like we're just going to get dismissed, like, you know, kind of scoffing at our concerns, like it's going to be okay, it's going to be all right, you know. And I think it's tempting to dismiss our problems because we haven't experienced as much life as you, obviously. We don't have the years that you do. But even if our problems seem trivial, you know, when we feel dismissed, it's hurtful. And I think I love how in Jesus' ministry, there were people from the messiest backgrounds that felt so safe with him. And I think it speaks to his gentleness. You know, I think about the woman in Luke 7, right? It says that she was known as a sinful woman. That's what she was known as. And she went to a Pharisee's house just because she had heard that Jesus was there. And if you think about that moment, she's standing behind Jesus. She's weeping. She's wiping his feet with her tears, with her hair. What was it about Jesus that made her feel like she could completely unravel in front of him? What was it about Jesus that made her feel like I can be safe with him, enough to go to a Pharisee's house and do this? You know, and I think it could have been easy for Jesus to dismiss her or respond a different way, but, you know, Matthew 11, Jesus says about himself, I am gentle and I am humble in heart. And I think this is one of the things we really need from the older generation. We need gentleness. You know, we need a safe place to talk to. We need you to patiently listen and meet us where we're at. You know, and I think when conversations like that happen, it brings a lot of hope.
I feel like when we have that safe place, then we're gonna go change the world. You know, we're gonna make a big difference. And after once you have that safe place, to me, the next thing we need is something we call high expectations and high belief. There's a quote from this book. It's called The Pandemic Population. It was written early on in the pandemic, talking about what it's like growing up, you know, in this particular environment. And it had a really interesting study where it says a group of psychologists from Stanford, Yale, Columbia, and other institutions set out to explore how teachers could offer feedback that would elicit the best effort from students in their classrooms. To their surprise, teachers found that there was one type of feedback that improved student effort to such a degree that they called it magical. Effort rose a minimum of 40% among white students and 320% among black students. The feedback was simply, I am giving these comments because I have high expectations of you and I know you can reach them. Notice how expectations are combined with belief. Added to the high expectations is the phrase, I know you can reach them. It's a statement of belonging and belief as well as expectation. You're good enough to be here. When we feel valued, believed in, and called to a high expectation, I believe the younger generation is gonna meet it. So they usually meet whatever expectations are put on them with the belief. If the expectations are low, They're gonna meet that. If we raise the bar and pump belief into them, they're gonna hit that expectation as well. And again, we're so lucky to be in a church that really does care and believe the next generation. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much to the younger generation. We have the most incredible older generation ever. Okay, mm-hmm. Like what they have been through. They have survived wars. They've faced economic recession. They've been immigrants. They've preached the gospel around the world. Mm-hmm. They endured 9/11. They were a part of the civil rights movement. They walked through the decades of wrestling in their faith. They even survived 80s fashion. That's pretty awesome, you know? We should constantly be thanking the older generation for going before us.
Yeah.
It is so easy to get arrogant as a young person.
Yep.
It is so easy. Youthful pride and arrogance is so real. Yeah. I remember it started when I was in fourth grade, all right? I was in fourth grade. I remember talking to my sister who was in first grade, and she was learning things like how to tell time and how to read a clock. You know, and me in my extremely intellectual fourth grade self came over and said, Mackenzie, your homework is so easy. Like, look at what I'm doing. I have to like write in paragraphs, okay? Like, I'm doing times tables. Like, like if I was doing your homework, like it'd be so easy for me. And like if you were doing like, mine is so hard, okay? And you know, my dad's kind of in the room and he hears me saying that to my little sister when I'm in fourth grade. And he says, hey Nick, can I talk to you for a sec? I'm like, yeah, sure. And he says, hey, so your homework is like ridiculously easy for me, okay? And so do you want me doing that to you? You know, talking like that to you? And I was like, No, you're right. You know, just completely humbled right there. And I think, though, it's so often for us to do that spiritually, mm-hmm. where we can kind of, because we think we have some sort of knowledge, all of a sudden we're like, we think that we are so much better than X person, you know? And I think God is looking at us like, wow, okay, great. You learned something. You think you're the first person to ever realize that on the planet, you know, that ever existed. Great. You know, you're amazing, you know? Or I think even the older generation is like, hey, why don't you talk to us when you've been trying to do this for 30 years? When you've been fighting the good fight for 30 years, then maybe you can have a little bit of an opinion about some of those things. But I've seen that so much in myself. As I've learned, as I've grown up, I have to watch my own arrogance. Mm-hmm. And I've needed to repent a lot in my own just youthful pride.
Mm-hmm. And that's definitely me too. I think I've caught myself feeling sometimes really smug, you know, when I learn something. Like, I can think of myself as a unique little revolutionary. And I think my generation can get an arrogance that we're the first ones to break the mold. You know, we can feel like we're the first ones to maybe call out injustice and fight against it, but I've heard that one of the defining things for the millennial generation, which we're a part of, is victimization and self-pity. And I think we kind of love feeling misunderstood, you know? I think we enjoy being critical towards older people. And we get arrogant in thinking that we know better or we care more deeply, you know? And I love Ecclesiastes says over and over again, there is nothing new under the sun. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe the circumstances are different, but the emotions are the same for people who have broken different molds before us. You know, and that idea of questioning everything, it's not new, right? It's not a new phrase. And I just wanted to speak to my peers right now that are questioning everything. They're wrestling through stuff. You know, me too. We're with you. Mm-hmm. And I think it can be emotional and it can be disillusioning sometimes to question tradition, right? And I think we're just seeking authenticity. That's just what we're looking for. And it's so necessary and healthy to wrestle through that. And I'm encouraged that it's a big part of Jesus's ministry. You know, I love that moment when Jesus says to the Pharisees, go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, right? He's quoting to them a scripture that they've memorized and read their whole life, but he's basically saying, go and unpack what you think you knew. I want you to relearn, unlearn and relearn, you know, and that's just a part of discipleship. We should always be doing that, mm-hmm. you know, and I think breaking the mold is always going to be a part of listening to the Spirit, and we got to get used to that. But I think as young people, we have a choice of how we do that. We can either do that in an unhealthy way, which mm-hmm. is giving in to mistrust and doing it out of arrogance, you know, and getting defensive, or I think we can do it in a healthy way, which is choosing to love, choosing to trust, mm-hmm. you know, choosing to trust that God has put the people in our lives that he did for a reason. And I think in everything we do, rather than first getting defensive, we have to find out, how did Jesus do this? Mm-hmm. Like, fixing our gaze on Jesus is a literal command. Look at the Gospels, see how he loved, you know? And I think when we look at the Gospels, we realize, I think Jesus is a lot more concerned about our righteousness, like our right relationships with each other, than our rightness. Mm-hmm. And I think we've got to ask ourselves, how can I love while I'm going through this process, rather than who's right?
Amen. You know, there's a lot of people that say that it was a big deal when early on in the United States, when the presidency changed parties, and when it changed philosophies and ideologies, because it was a unique time in history where there was a differing of opinion, you know, that came in peacefully. And it was like, without violence or rebellion or starting their own thing. And I think we're in a unique time of our church right now where a lot of the people that have gone before us, that even kind of started our fellowship of churches, that have been pouring out their lives for the gospel for a long period of time, either are retiring or passing on, or and we are, as a younger generation, are coming into more leadership roles. And I think there's a really unique time in our history right now where we can make one of two decisions. We can choose to say, man, I'm going to build on this. I'm going to team up together, and we're going to take that even higher, built on the foundation that was laid. Or we can choose in our arrogance to branch off, to rebel against it, to start our own thing. And that just has happened so often in history. And I just want to see us say, man, as a younger generation, no, we ain't branching out. We are lifting this thing higher on the shoulders and foundations, you know, that were laid. You know, the older generation has put their blood and sweat and tears on the line. And it becomes so easy to sit on the sidelines as a younger generation and point the finger and criticize or complain instead of actually being in the arena, instead of trying to actually be in there and fight and help, you know, and try to advance the gospel the way that they have. Our critical thinking is good, but if we, it can be used often as an excuse to stop us from courageously engaging. We need people who are not obsessed with their own opinion, but who are obsessed with sitting at the feet of Jesus, who are obsessed with kind of looking at his words and diving into his words with a notebook, listening, and then courageously going in the world and putting it into practice, who are running into the world and bringing his light, where we crave every day to be just like Jesus. Not to make a name for ourselves, like the Tower of Babel, like we talked about, but to make a name for God. That every day we wake up and yearn to sit at his feet and listen and soak it in. We need people. We need our young people to love deeply, to wrap our arms around one another, to team up with the older generation and say, I'm in this with you. Let's do this together. When we do that, we're going to shock the world. It's going to be a beautiful place. To close out, we just want to give you guys one challenge for this week. And the challenge is find somebody, one person, older or younger, to spend time with this week and put into practice valuing, believing, and serving. We believe everybody in God's family should have someone older that they're reaching up to and someone younger that they're reaching down to. Write down someone's name right now that you could get with this week and just ask three questions from. We don't ask enough questions of each other anymore. Asking questions and curiously listening. You know, to end out in John 17, I love Jesus' dream where he says, I am praying not only for these disciples, but also for all who will ever believe in me through their message. I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. And may they be in us so that the world will believe you sent me. I have given them the glory you gave me so that they may be one as we are one. I am in them and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. Jesus' dream was for the church to be a beacon of hope and of light where the old and the young can come together and create something beautiful, create something extraordinary, that we can value one another, we can believe wholeheartedly in one another, and we can serve one another humbly and love. Mm-hmm. And as we remember Jesus right now, as we pray for the communion, just bask in how in the gratitude that we get to be in this together. Mm-hmm. Let's go to our master and pray and remember him in all that we do. Amen. Father, thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you that his example of caring for the younger and also caring for the older and bringing them together, even all throughout your scriptures, God, is such a huge theme of your plan and your promise to us. Help us be humble. Help us be gentle. Help us be courageous. Help us set high expectations for one another, but also pump each other with belief. Help us value and care for one another and see the value in the older generation and see the value in the younger generation. Believe and trust both and serve them humbly in love. Give us the power to do that. We love you, Jesus. Thank you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Teamwork makes the dream work, right? Here we are. Thank you so much, Brian. So I feel like I should introduce myself. Back at church, as we are. Ross McKenzie, nice to see everybody. Both, we look good, 100, 150. You can fit 100, 150 in a 750 auditorium. It works okay, and sounds like next Sunday we'll have even a few more. So that's fantastic. It's great being together. This is that time in the service where we typically talk about our giving and make our offering to the Lord. We'll do that. I like to talk about God and Jesus, though, even more. I mean, it's the Passover. You know, we're moving into Easter, and the whole world looks a little bit at God and Jesus this time of year, and I think we should take advantage of it and really grow our spiritually ourselves and our understanding of God and his generous nature, his sparing his people, and liberating them from Egyptian bondage and persevering with them. You know how often they rebelled and complained and then came back and then followed and then rebelled and complained and came back and followed. Sounds like human nature to me. Even us these days, sometimes we're that way, right? And yet God is so incredibly faithful. The Passover is about God's divine kindness. Spend a little bit of time this week thinking about God's divine kindness. Then think a little bit this week, too, about Jesus as we lead up to Easter. I've been thinking about how did he spend the last 2 weeks of his life prior to dying and trying to do some of the same things, have some of the same attitudes, you know, go the same places that he did. And it's a good exercise. I'm trying to do that during the year, be like Jesus, but it's a good couple weeks to do that as well, I would say. But Jesus, of course, was amazing, and we do everything in remembrance of him. We're motivated by him. We feel loved by him, and that's why we've stayed faithful together. He entered in on a donkey. He allowed people to shout, "Hosanna, glory to be God in the highest." He knew who he was. He humbled himself, but he understood that people need to worship, and he was God's son, and he was about to die for our sins and be raised from the dead. I want to talk about us, though, too, that we've been faithful together, and we're also better together. And it's wonderful to be faithful together. We've worshiped. We've continued to outreach. We've continued to be generous. It's been encouraging. When I read Ephesians 6, and over again, it says we need to stand firm. We need to stand our ground. We need to stay together. after everything in this epic spiritual battle that we continue to be in, we need to stand. And that's what we've done. I want to thank you and encourage you and hope that builds up your faith. You know, when we talk about blood, sweat, and tears, we have certainly done that for the church. We feel as a response to God's blood, sweat, and tears, that that's an appropriate response to grace. I would also add blood, sweat, tears, and money, because that's what we've done over the last 10 years, 20, 30, 40 years. We don't go back and count it up. Instead, we look at what God's done and accomplished. And he's certainly done some things in the last few decades and believe he'll continue to do that. This last 3 months has been some very good weekly giving. Good job. Congratulations. Thank you. We've been able to continue to take care of all of our responsibilities that we committed to as a church. And we've also been able to help so many people, other churches, mission work around the world. The next 3 months, I encourage you to be praying about our season of generosity, April, May, and June. Our fiscal year ends on June 30. So we'd like to know how we're going to fund next year. And so it'll be based somewhat on, very directly, on how we give in our season of giving over the next 3 months. You know, over the last 12 months, some of us have struggled mightily financially, and I encourage you, hang in there and do your best. Others, the stock market's up, government gifts keep landing in our savings account, and I encourage you, give more than ever. The mission is still great. The beacon of light is still who we are. There's no other solution than this light on a hill where the old and young and every other dividing wall that you see is broken down and comes together under the banner of Jesus. Love being here with you. I love that we can give generously together. I think it's a testimony. We weren't sure about church attendance. It's kind of hard to track it when we're in our homes, but it's real tangible what's getting deposited into the church bank account, and that we've continued to be able to do what we've wanted to do. We have a sports ministry kicking back in May. I want to talk to my vaccinated maskless friends. Join me at 7:00 next Sunday outdoors. I'll see you there. And those who weren't able to give for a period of time, I encourage you to not only come back, but start giving again. The children's classes are in, 5th grade and under. The camp is registering April 15th. Evidently, we saved the swamp. That's a good thing. A lot of individuals gave $500. And we from North River over the last 15 years have given $500,000. And that's you. That's me. That's us. That's one tangible example of our consistent season of giving. We had to decide 15 years ago what we wanted to continue with. We thought about chickening out, but we didn't. And so we've continued to give generously and have a time period every year where we give an extra special amount. I'm going to lead us in a prayer, and I hope that's helpful for you. Dear Lord, we're grateful to be together. We're just thankful that we can give to you. We feel so given to. We've been so fortunate, blessed, loved. Our redemption in Christ is so costly to you and so precious to us. God, help us to feel loved, to give generously out of appreciation, out of the gratitude in our hearts. Help us to stand firm together, knowing that we are being faithful together. Help us to stick together. Those of us who have wandered off a bit, help us to come back in fully. We love you with all our hearts. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Okay, I'm going to share a few announcements with us and also a couple of comments. Thank you, Ross. I love it when Ross just shares about us as a church. He's always going to get emotional at some point in that. I think we all know, because he deeply loves and deeply cares, like so many of you, obviously those of you that are here this morning and so many hundreds that are joining us, you know, online. Our diversity as a church was in full view, you know, today, wasn't it? Not only things we talked about, but just of what you've been able to see. Ray and Ross, a couple of our elders up here leading in that wonderful way. Nick and Bree and Chase as part of that next generation, you know, upcoming. Our church is so diverse. you know, from our new 97-year-old sister Doris, who you saw on the screen a little while ago and joined us in our Women's Month activities, to Mike Johnson's 99-year-old dad, who is logged in with us this morning via live stream. We love you, Ed, and we're all family, you know, together. And we got new babies, you know, here in the auditorium here. A growing number of us are coming on out to church. The church campus is gradually opening up. One of my favorite aspects of today was going back into the 4 and 5 year old classroom. Those guys are kicking it this morning. The teachers, the kids, they're having such a great time. More and more of our kids are coming. Melissa, Billy, thank you for you and your volunteers for all you're doing. Our classes are opening up. We'll have classes on Easter all the way up through the fifth grade. And let me say something about that at this point. It's a little bit stormy out there today. You can tell by some of our hair, you know, sitting here in the auditorium, you know, obviously. But more than that, you know, it's amazing that we can all be together and to be able to serve. But next week, the forecast is for clear and sunny skies. And we've got an exciting, compelling gatherings that are going to take place here on the North River campus next week. And so we'll have our 11 o'clock service, as we generally do. I think you'll probably see a graphic about it. It's our Easter service, Pierced and Perfected. We've met with our COVID task force team, the leadership group. We're expanding out safely. We can have 200 people in this auditorium, you know, in the proper spacing and continuing on with our masking as we've done it here in this auditorium inside. And so that's going to be a wonderful thing. We've got a brand new film put together by our creative arts team that's going to be very compelling and a beautiful service here at 11 o'clock that you'll be able to access really all around Atlanta and the world as so many people tune into us on a Sunday morning at 11 a.m. Easter morning. Also, as Ross just alluded to, at 7 o'clock in the morning, right here on our church campus in the parking lot, we'll be having a sunrise service. Bring your lawn chairs, no registration, masks are gonna be optional. We're gonna have a great time out there and really enjoy being together and worshiping in two very different kind of ways, but all honoring the resurrected Jesus Christ. Because whether we're young or old, and we have our leadership team at this church is composed of older and younger, each generation working together so beautifully. You see it illustrated pretty much every Sunday. We're working together, and the one thing we and everybody in this auditorium have in common is Jesus is Lord. That is the number one thing, you know, that binds us together, and we'll continue to be able to do that. We're going to close out our service with a great song, Blessed Quietness. And Kyrie, one of our young next generation creative arts and singles ministry interns, is going to lead us in worship. Let's stand up together and end out in a wonderful way.
Amen. Let's sing. We're going to sing. I know this is an oldie but goodie, maybe new to some of you, but it's call and response. It's a beautiful song. We'll have a good time. Let's slap our hands. Blessed quietness.
Blessed quietness.
A holy quietness.
Holy quietness.
What assurance.
What assurance.
In my soul.
In my soul.
Stormy sea,
on that stormy sea,
Jesus speaks to me,
Jesus speaks to me,
and he makes the billows
cease to roll, to roll, to roll.
Blessed quietness,
blessed quietness,
a holy quietness,
holy quietness,
and what assurance,
what assurance
in my soul. To me,
Jesus speaks to me,
and he makes the billows
sing.
God, and we sing it up.
Blessed quietness.
Blessed quietness.
Holy quietness.
Holy quietness.
What assurance.
What assurance.
In my soul.
In my soul.
On that stormy sea.
On that stormy sea.
My Jesus speaks to me.
Jesus speaks to me. He makes the billows cease to roll, to roll.
Joining us this morning, we pray you have a faithful week. You can head outside and please social distance. We love you guys. Have a great week.